I use perspective rulers and clip steel paint to help me draw all of these pieces on screen, and if you've never tried to learn perspective or use perspective rulers, you might be wondering, why do I even need to learn perspective rulers or complex perspective? Why can't I just stick to drawing pretty characters on white backgrounds? Well, I want to bring up perhaps a new argument, and that's nostalgia. So this might seem weird, but to elaborate on what I mean, recently I had a dream where I revisited my childhood home. I won't read out the entirety of this comic, but they're here on the screen, so feel free to pause and read if you'd like. In my dream, I was walking around my childhood home and I tried to take pictures. I saw the fruit trees, the rooms, the hallways I hadn't seen in years. But in reality, it's impossible for me to revisit and to take pictures of the house because later the home was sold and then torn down. Even though the drawings here are very rough, and I obviously didn't use perspective rulers for these, I think that by understanding some perspective and through using perspective rulers in the past, it helped me better convey my story, and in a way, helped me resolve some of that feeling of nostalgia. A few months back, I did this piece in a similar vein, and also incorporated some things that I won't see again, and obviously, since this one is much more rendered, I was able to achieve this by utilizing perspective rulers. Everyone has their own history and experiences, and part of the reason why I take photos and videos or draw backgrounds so much is that I think there's something really special about drawing a specific place in a specific moment in time, and I really think that by learning perspective, and especially utilizing Clip Studio Paint's perspective rulers, it can help if you're not sure where to start. So now that I've hopefully convinced you, let's start off with some basic perspective. I covered this in a prior video, but for a quick recap, you can generally break down perspective into three parts: the horizon line, or eye level, the vanishing point, and any vanishing lines that are emerging from the vanishing point. Aside from one-point perspective, there's also two-point and three-point perspective. One-point perspective has a singular vanishing point along the horizon line, and lines that are perpendicular to the horizon will have lines that converge at that one vanishing point. Meanwhile, with two-point perspective, we have two points somewhere along the horizon line, and lines that are perpendicular, or in other words, straight to the horizon, will have lines that converge at either of the vanishing points, depending on the direction that it's facing. With three-point perspective, we still have those two vanishing points along the horizon line, and then we have also one additional point above or below the horizon line. Here, vertical lines will converge at the third vanishing point instead of being straight up and down. So when I mention things converge at one of these vanishing points, I don't necessarily mean everything converges. Using this commission that I drew as an example, here you'll see that this is a typical two-point perspective if we align the chair and the bookshelves. However, the coffee table and some of the objects on the table don't align to the same vanishing point. However, it's not like the table is floating either. This is because despite not following the same vanishing point, it's still vanishing on the same horizon line, which gives it the feeling of being grounded. You might be wondering though, but what about fisheye perspective? Well, fisheye perspective, or curvilinear perspective, is a type of wide-angle perspective which distorts or curves the edges. It's most noticeable for very wide-angle camera lenses, where parts of the image, like the pillars here, sort of start to curve. But when you overlay a grid over it, and then start to zoom out, it's important to think of it sort of like being projected onto a globe. Technically, in reality, all perspective slightly curves at the edges because, simply put, our eyeballs are round. But for typical fisheye perspective, we can get that look by making these distortions more extreme along the edges here. So now that we've established some basic perspective, let's get into how to actually use Clip Studio Paint's perspective rulers in order to speed up your drawing process. So there are two primary ways that you can create perspective rulers in Clip Studio Paint. The first and most easiest way to create one is go under Layer, Ruler slash Frame, and then click Create Perspective Ruler. Here you can select the type, either 1-point, 2-point, or 3-point perspective, enable Create on a new layer or not, and then also enable or disable fisheye perspective. For now, I'll go ahead and click 1-point perspective and disable fisheye perspective. So here we have a basic 1-point perspective grid. The other way to create a perspective grid is to do it manually, by going under Create Ruler, and then click Perspective Ruler, and then under Tool Property Process, make sure that Add Vanishing Point is selected. You can click and drag anywhere on the canvas to determine where your vanishing point will be. Here where these two lines intersect will be where the vanishing point is, and it will create a 1-point perspective grid like this. And then now, when you draw, as long as you make sure that Snap to Special Rulers is enabled, whenever you draw with your pen, it should snap to the special ruler, in this case, the perspective grid. If you wanted to add more vanishing points to this 1-point perspective, you can do that by making sure that the process is still set to add vanishing point, and then make sure that change perspective type is enabled. Then you can just click and drag your mouse to form where you want the other vanishing point to be. And now, if I clear this, then this is 2-point perspective. Sometimes when you're adding another vanishing point and you accidentally make the vanishing point slightly above or below the first one, and it makes your whole horizon line slanted. If you want to correct this, just go under Object, click the horizon line, and then under this tool property panel, click Horizontalize Eye Level. This will make the eye level straight again. Alternatively, under this menu, you can adjust a lot of things, including where these rulers or guides show up, where the midsection of this is, adjust the angle of the eye level, and enable or disable certain rulers. Also under this menu, if you scroll down, you can also enable or disable fisheye perspective for an existing grid here. If you zoom out, you'll be able to see more clearly how the grid is being projected onto this globe shape. Also under here, you can enable and disable the XY plane, the YZ plane, or the XZ plane to show or hide the grid visibility. Another thing you can do is if you wanted to, for example, create a guide for something that is rotated on the same horizon plane, you can do that by just disabling the change perspective type. Now, when I create a new vanishing point, say somewhere over here, now it'll create another vanishing point, but the main ruler here is still enabled as well. Also, at any time, you can just click off to disable the Snap to Special ruler, and you'll be able to draw off the perspective grid. This is helpful if you're drawing details or characters that aren't straight and aligned to the grid exactly. So now that I've covered the basics of perspective and how to use rulers in Clip Studio Paint, let's do a drawing demonstration. After sketching my thumbnails and then setting up the perspective rulers, I'll go ahead and share the Speedpaint. Since this video was mostly about how to use rulers in perspective, I'm also going to take this time now to talk about nostalgia, art, preservation, and creation. There are lots of places like my childhood home where I don't have any good proper photos of anymore. There are also places that I did take photos of, but I can't revisit to take better ones, even with newer technology. More than just drawing to improve my art or to draw a pretty picture, I also want to draw to preserve, to draw to share what I like, including places and things that I like. At least in my opinion, I think it's important to take more photos, learn more perspective, and use the tools available to you, not only to improve your art for skill reasons, but also as a form of preserving memory, and to share parts of yourself and your own history with others through the medium of your art. Of course, everyone has different goals that they want to achieve with their art, and I'm not saying that you have to learn perspective if that's not the direction that you want to go in. But as for me, one of the big reasons why I'm such an advocate for going out and taking photos and using them as reference in my own art is not only for the skill and understanding aspect, but also because I think that by incorporating parts of my life or places that I've been in my art, it feels like I'm preserving a part of me and making my experiences or even nostalgia something more beautiful than a memory that I can't ever go back to. And I think that every single person has something important to share or to draw, as everyone has obviously lived their own interesting lives and their own lived experiences. I think this could be applied to every area and not just perspective. I often advocate for people to learn art, even if they don't feel like they're a particularly good artist, because just like with the earlier comic that I did, the art itself isn't really great by any measure, but it tells a story using visuals and helps to capture what words can't entirely capture on its own. And for today's drawing, I drew the plum trees I love so much in my old backyard, in my childhood home, just like how I remembered. I never did get a photo of the place that I ate so many plums under every summer, but through drawing it based on my memory, now I have this physical visual that I can look back on and also share with you guys. I won't do my regular outro today, and instead I just want to say that I hope that even if you don't use perspective rulers or draw something very rendered, I hope that this will at least inspire you to draw a place that you love, whether from now or in the past, or even a place that you want to go to in the future. I think that what's really special about art and drawing is the ability to visualize and create what might not even exist anymore. One day, what will seem like an ordinary thing today might feel irreplaceably special in the future.